Well, hello again, Dave.
Hello. It's been a while.
It's been a while, yeah, been a few minutes. We talked just earlier about the essential elements. Now I thought we could dive into some of the toxic elements and how you built that up in the graph and how we should use it or how we should read it.
Okay. Well, basically, we'll discuss this section of the graph, which is termed the toxic elements, and it's in the pink area. And these are basically heavy metals that we're looking at, and they include uranium, arsenic, beryllium, mercury, cadmium, lead, and aluminum. And we have a white area here in the graph showing that the reference interval, everyone should be below this pink area.
All right.
That would be ideal, you know, is when the element is in the white area. And when it gets into the light pink, that's a cautionary range. When it gets into the dark pink, that is a high range that would be considered excessive. And any level in that, even in the light pink area, would be considered a burden.
So when something, you know, like you see this person has several pollutants, I guess, or heavy metal in them, but like the aluminum here, that's just nothing to worry about?
Right. If it's in the white area, that's within the reference interval, and everyone has these present in their body. There's no one that's free of them.
All right.
However, there are varying degrees of how much they may have. And so, for example, in this case, this mercury is quite low, but it's below calibration. In other words, we could test for smaller and smaller amounts.
But right.
And the effort and the it would not make any clinical significance. So we want everyone to be at least in this area of white. And so we can't say that level of aluminum has any clinical significance.
All right. So I don't have to feel sick if I have that level of aluminum. I don't have to start sweating or feel bad about
it. No, because we all
have some of it.
Have some of it in our body. We all have all of these elements in our body. And the idea is just not to become too excessive.
Yeah. All right. So I know from using this for several years that you have a system where if you have certain minerals that are, you know, reasonable levels of certain minerals, that will protect you against toxicity. So I may be confusing you, but.
No,
for instance, the what is it called? Quicksilver, the
mercury,
and iron, and selenium, and
yes,
so forth.
Yes, correct. So, well, the second part of this graph actually illustrates the relationship of the heavy metals to the protective minerals, and so this section of the graph called toxic ratios here we'll just discuss for a moment. And basically, when we're reviewing this, we're comparing the heavy metal to the protective mineral.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every mineral has an anti-effect on a heavy metal retention and so forth. Yeah. And when we look at this graph, we call it the toxic ratios, and many people become confused with it, but we should see these all in this white area and not in the pink area. The white area would be acceptable, and they can go as high as infinity. So we want those ratios to be extremely high. And the first one is showing calcium to lead, for example. Now, calcium is very antagonistic to lead. Calcium deficiency would lead to increased lead deposition in the body. And that should be at least 84 times the amount of calcium should be present relative to lead. So even if a person didn't have an extremely high lead level, but their calcium to lead ratio was only 40 or 20, then it would indicate that metal could be having an adverse effect. And so on the toxic ratios, we evaluate them not only from their level, but their relationship with the other protective elements. And these should all be as high as possible to be protective.
So just to take your example here, so if you're low on calcium, that makes lead poisoning more alarming.
Yes, it would. A calcium deficiency would allow an increase in lead retention in the body, and compared to having a normal calcium level. And this is why children see are so much more susceptible to the adverse effects of lead, because they are sympathetic dominant, they have low calcium levels typically, and so they'll retain as much as 50% more lead from ingestion than an adult would.
Okay. So where does the lead go?
Oh, it's heavy metals generally are deposited throughout the body. Some have an affinity, you know, like mercury has an affinity for the kidney, for example. But lead goes throughout the body, as the kidneys and so forth, but ultimately the bone. That's where lead is typically deposited.
Okay. All right. Is it such that, you know, mercury, for instance, if you have low iron levels, will the mercury come in and do the job or try to replace iron for functionality in the cells, or is it just polluting the cells?
It's in a sense polluting or poisoning the cells, and the iron and zinc, selenium, these have various functions on preventing that from occurring. For example, it's well known, like selenium, binds to mercury. It doesn't eliminate it from the body, however, it binds it and forms a selenium mercury compound, and it becomes less toxic. It doesn't have the toxic effect, even if it's in the cell, but it doesn't eliminate it, whereas zinc is necessary for the mobilization and excretion of mercury, and iron helps to antagonize mercury and so on. And so a person's protein status is very important for the mobilization and elimination of heavy metals in general, because the sulfur helps to antagonize heavy metals in general.
Okay, because I'm, and I may have, some of the therapists have told me that if you have too little iron, or too little of that, a heavy metal can come in and try to replace the original metal, because the body doesn't have enough of iron or something, it will try to find something else that can do the job of iron.
Yes.
And it's like a poor worker, replacing a good one.
Well, I think a good example, so you have metals that displace other elements, and then you have metals that poison the enzyme systems.
Okay.
And don't necessarily antagonize a metal, but poison the enzyme system of the cell. But cadmium is a great example of displacement. If you have cadmium and zinc, they're both very similar as far as their atomic structure, but of course cadmium is a heavier metal, and so it can actually, in high quantities, can displace zinc. And it can actually possibly take over some of those enzyme functions, but it does a very, very poor job of
and
you would suffer adverse consequence of that. But also, if you have a zinc deficiency, then your tendency to retain cadmium is going to be much greater than if you didn't.
Right.
We're all exposed to cadmium, in the environment. It's a common environmental contaminant, and so some people don't have any effects from it. They don't retain it. Others retain some. Others may retain a lot, that depends on their biochemical status, on how these heavy metals are going to affect them.
And we have seen when I've seen some of the caseworks that some of the experienced therapists have done in Norway, and for instance on mercury, we have seen patients coming in testing very low for all toxic elements, but also high or low on the other elements, and then as we start rebalancing them, suddenly these toxic elements show up, and they can go really high. And then they go down again, and you think you're rid of them, but suddenly they're back up again as you start rebalancing them. Is that common, or how?
That's not uncommon, depending on how much is there. The first test that we do from the analysis, the first mineral test that we do on a person, it's a point in time. How long have they had that pattern? We don't know that, although we can get an idea of the chronicity of a pattern. To some degree, or their health history may tell us that, but if they were exposed to a heavy metal in the past, and that has deposited in tissues like the bone, the kidneys, the spleen, the liver obviously is a big one, and you start balancing that chemistry, and that increases the ability of the body to you know, to attach ligands to that, mobilize it from the cell, take it throughout, you know, into the blood for excretory, to excretory routes, the kidney, the liver, and so forth. Well, the hair acting as a minor excretory route, you know, it is.
Right.
The body does take toxins out through the hair, through the skin, and so forth. Then that can be reflected on a follow-up as an increase in that heavy metal. It was present before, but we didn't see it because it was like the tip of the iceberg. We're seeing, you know, a certain amount. And as it starts being mobilized, if it's excessive, it's not unusual to see it to elevate. Now, it can elevate up and down some elements because some elements store, you know, in a greater abundance, like in, with copper, for example. We can see that go up and down, up and down, up and down. Whereas on the heavy metals like mercury or cadmium, we'll typically see those go up to a high point and then they'll start coming back down and into a normal. But it depends on how much is present for that to occur and how many different deposition areas have been exposed.
One of the big ones in Norway is uranium. You know, we have a lot of the what do you call it, the ground for it.
The granite.
So lots of the patients come in and they are they have trouble with uranium. Is there a, you know, is there a way to clean that out like the other metals? You know, like iron and zinc will take care of mercury. Can we do something with uranium the same way?
Yes, the uranium, see, is laid down very similar to lead. You know, it has you know, deposition into the bone ultimately, and so the same factors that we use for lead, we would use for uranium as well. But obviously, the first thing to do is to try to limit exposure to it.
Yeah.
And we've had some extreme poisonings or excesses of uranium in the U.S., you know, particularly in the Northeast. And you know, we've seen those mobilized and returned to normal after exposure was stopped.
So stop exposure and then just go through the rebalancing and that will kind of clean the body out for from the uranium.
Yes, you see, many times, you know, the heavy metal, well, let me say it this way. People look at heavy metals maybe a little differently than I do, okay? When a person has a heavy metal, many times a practitioner may say, oh, that's your problem, is this uranium or this lead or this cadmium. And they want to just direct all their efforts to that element of elimination. But to me, the heavy metal is present for a reason. In other words, there's some imbalance that allow that to be there, which you have to address first, rather than just trying to address the mobilization. I've seen people who have been on chelation therapy, intravenous chelation therapy for years, and their heavy metals are still present. And obviously, it does take it out. You know, their urinary excretion will show this elevation of lead and so forth from the chelation. But the chelation is not necessarily getting into the cell. If it's bound to a ligand there, it's not. The body doesn't want to release these metals in the blood in a free form, you know, because they're extremely toxic. They have to be bound and carried out. And so, in my opinion, the way to address heavy metals, obviously, is to look for a source and eliminate it. But the other thing is you have to get the body into the ability to excrete it, to mobilize it and excrete it. And when the body does that on its own terms, on its own time, you know, it's not a fast process. It is a gradual, relatively speaking, you know, like maybe months, you know, compared to very quickly with IV. The body, I don't think, will harm itself in doing that. You know, it's gently done. Whereas intravenous chelation and some of these other even oral chelating agents, they take the metals out through an abnormal excretory route. You know, for example, most of them will bring the metals out through the kidney, and they should not be excreted through the kidney, although they can be. But then you have to really watch for the potential of harm by using those if a person has compromised renal function. So,
but just to get back to the uranium, How do you, you know, can you protect yourself against uranium? I mean, like with a cadmium, if you have enough zinc, you will withstand exposure to cadmium. Is there something you can do to withstand the uptake of uranium?
Yes, yes, you can. You know, the again, just like any other metal, the more balanced your minerals are, the less ability you're going to have, or less susceptibility to retaining it. But you have to understand in those areas of Scandinavia, as well as in the U.S., you have to limit that intake. Yeah. And if it is a water source, you know, and they're drinking, consuming it, that can overwhelm,
yes,
you know, your body and start, yeah, producing deficiencies, yeah, you know, that weren't there, yeah, initially.
So it won't. So being balanced doesn't necessarily protect you against exposure to uranium.
No.
Uranium is going to get into your body. If it's
correct,
there, it's going to go in there.
Correct.
You can help yourself by being balanced, but you can't eliminate it.
Right. I like to, and that's a good point that you bring up. I like to distinguish the difference between a heavy metal, you know, exposure or burden, and a toxicity. See, those are two different things. Many people erroneously use a term of like mercury toxicity or uranium toxicity or lead toxicity, and I don't like that term because everybody has a burden and they can have an excess level, but it's not to the point that is the toxicity.
Okay.
Toxicity, you know, overwhelms the system.
Right.
In other words, if we're walking around walk into a room with mercury vapor, we're going to become poisoned right,
yes,
away.
Yes.
We're gonna, and that's going to overburden anything,
yes,
regardless of our chemistry. But that's a toxicity, and it needs to be treated immediately.
Mm.
You know,
mm,
and not over time,
right,
with a burden.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So you drop the atomic bomb, you're going to be wiped out.
Right. Right.
It doesn't help to be balanced.
Makes no difference. Exactly.
All right. Well, thank you so much, David. I appreciate your time. And we'll leave it at that for the toxic elements.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.